So Marie, in your opinion, what makes a good presenter?
A good presenter has three main qualities.
Mm-hmm.
They have to have credibility with the audience, so they have to be very present and totally in the moment when they're delivering their message.
Mm-hmm.
They have to have emotional connection with their audience.
Definitely.
And they have to have good logical structure in the message they're delivering, especially if it's persuasive.
I guess because they're like in a condensed period of time, yeah, that's important that they can get a message around across very quickly.
And effectively, absolutely. Don't waste people's time.
Exactly. So what do you see as the difference between a good presenter and a good facilitator?
A good presenter, I think they don't necessarily have to know their subject matter as thoroughly. They still have to know it very, very well. But to me, a good presenter, they have got the upper hand because they're able to structure that presentation a certain way. They then can almost solicit certain questions from the audience,
mm-hmm.
so they have more control over the process. Whereas a good trainer, mm-hmm. facilitator, they don't tend to have as much control. They really, a training session can go pretty much any way depending on the dynamics mm-hmm. of the group. Yes, you do your homework beforehand, you find mm-hmm. out a lot about that, but you really have to be a lot more flexible.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be ready for lots of questioning, and you need to know your subject matter inside out, back to front.
Definitely, good point. So you mentioned presence before, so how do you identify presence? You know, someone who's got it versus someone who doesn't have it.
Someone who's truly present
mm-hmm.
is in the moment.
Mm-hmm.
They're totally giving you their undivided attention, which means a warmth factor of that person goes up,
mm-hmm.
the charisma factor of that person goes up. So they're usually very, very charismatic.
Mm-hmm.
And you know you've been in the presence of someone who is charismatic with presence
mm-hmm.
when you walk away from them and you feel very special. You feel that they've given you their undivided attention. So it's a wonderful quality to have.
Absolutely. So Marie, how do you identify someone that has presence versus someone who doesn't have presence? What is it?
The person with presence
mm-hmm.
makes people around them feel that they are truly listened to
mm-hmm.
and that they feel very special
mm-hmm.
and they feel totally heard. There's a great famous story about two politicians, two British mm-hmm. politicians, Disraeli and Gladstone.
Okay.
And both of them, it was really close to the election, both going for the prime ministership.
Mm-hmm.
It was about a week before the election, and one of the journalists found out that there was a high society lady that had dined with Mr. Gladstone on the Wednesday night and Mr. Disraeli on the Thursday night, so he just couldn't help himself. He asks her the difference between the two men. What was it like dining with Mr. Gladstone as opposed to Disraeli? And she said, well, after leaving the dining room table, sitting next to Mr. Gladstone,
mm-hmm.
I felt that I was in the presence of the most brilliant man in Britain. And she said the next evening, after leaving the dining table with Mr. Disraeli,
mm-hmm.
I felt that he was in the presence of the most brilliant woman in Britain. So there were no prizes in guessing. Disraeli, he was genuinely interested in people,
mm-hmm.
and he was very charismatic and was fully present in the moment whenever he communicated.
Mm-hmm.
He won the election, hands down apparently, but he was really known for that sense of presence and charisma.
Mm-hmm. Rose, what are three things that people could do to improve their presence?
The three key points I would advise are to make sure your mindset is fully present.
Mm-hmm.
The second one would be to make sure you are actively listening when you're engaging people and communicating with people. And the third would be that you are genuinely interested in people.
Right. Can you just elaborate on each of those points for us?
The first thing I think is their mindset.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be, well, they have to be fully present. So what's happening in our mind plays out in our body language, and
mm-hmm.
our voice
True.
Is the ultimate outcome,
mm-hmm.
our vocal image. So it's really important that we understand that our mind, body, and voice are combined.
Mm-hmm.
Get that mindset right.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to be, to do that, if you can actively listen, that's a second point,
mm-hmm.
and truly give people your undivided attention. Hearing, we just perceive sound.
Mm-hmm.
Listening, we falls into two categories.
Mm-hmm.
The first one's passive listening, And the second one is active listening. Now, passive is when we're just only partly listening. Mm-hmm. Our mindset is we're worried about either rebuttal or we're anxious about something and we lose our presence. Mm-hmm. Whereas active listening is being basically what Disraeli did, giving someone your undivided attention. Nothing mm-hmm. else can interfere. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the highest compliments you can give someone mm-hmm. because you've been fully present with them.
Can I share a story as well? I remember years ago there was a networking function. And one person went around and they didn't share any information about themselves. They just asked questions and engaged with people. At the end of the night, people had to vote on who was the most interesting person. And this person, 90% of people, voted for them. It's just amazing. And yet they didn't share one thing about themselves. It was just asking the questions and having that being fully present with the people that were talking with.
It's very charismatic, that person would have been. And third point is they would be genuinely interested in people. You have to be genuinely. Because in Australia, I think we can detect that insincerity very quickly. The Australian is very direct with that.
They have that filter.
We do.
So, Marie, what do you think is the most important thing a trainer or a facilitator needs to consider when they're delivering a session?
I think they have to leave their ego outside the door if they can. Now, basically, I think we've got to ensure that you've got a healthy, balanced ego mm-hmm. because that really sabotages. If your ego is unhealthy and mm-hmm. imbalanced, it'll sabotage from the outset and it's mm-hmm. a disaster. So I think that would be the one thing I would advise.
Oh, that's lovely. And it speaks to my heart because for me, when you're in a training room, the most important people are the learners in front of you. For them to walk away with some practical tools to improve their performance and behaviours. So
absolutely agree with you, Kerry. We're on the same page.
So thank you for that. The next thing we're going to do is the quick 5 questions,
okay,
which we ask every people that we're interviewing going forward in 2018. So are you ready?
Yes, I think so.
All right. Number one.
Okay.
If you weren't in the L&D field, what would you be doing?
This sounds going to sound weird, but I'd like to make really elaborate lampshades. That's what I'd love to do. I love fabric. I've got a passion for fabric and light, and I'd love to combine them.
Oh, I'd love to see your place and have a look at how you decorate it. Number two, what is your number one learning tip?
To master the art of storytelling. I think it's really, really, really important.
Absolutely.
Wonderful skill to have.
Mm-hmm. And you can use it at so many different places within a training session. So, at the start, to build credibility, to elaborate. So, I love that one. Three, what drives you to work in our industry?
Deep down, I believe everyone has a story and a message that they need to share to the world. Mm-hmm. And just that, all of us at some stage of our lives just mm-hmm. need a little bit of assistance in delivering that really important message.
True. Four, what is your favourite technology or tool that you use and why?
I use little wooden blowpipes for breathing. I teach people to breathe a certain way, deep breathing from their diaphragm. It's really, mm-hmm. really important for voice. And they can master that, they think, but then they need to get a certain depth so they can get speech tunes in their voice and have a nice modulation and register. And to do that, they need to breathe, really fill that lung fully. Mm-hmm. And so these pipes just show them, they're wonderful, they're lots of fun.
Wow,
all adults and big kids deep down, they're great little blowpipes.
All right, last one. As a facilitator, what is the one must-have thing in your training kit?
To have a plan, you always come with your plan A, but to have a plan B and a plan C.
Okay.
If things go wrong, make sure you've covered all your bases.
Marie, one thing that I really love about what you've done with your career is that you've specialised in one particular area rather than a broad brush of different topics. So you've really done well and you're doing some marvellous things with helping people find their authentic voice. So well done.
Thank you very much and thanks for asking me along too, Kerry.